बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। इंशाल्लाह टुडे वी विल कवर द रिमेनिंग पार्ट ऑफ द लेक्चर, लंग्स। देर आर टू टाइप्स ऑफ आर्टीरियल सिस्टम विच आर सप्लाइंग द लंग्स। वन इज नॉन रेस्पायरेटरी सर्किट एंड वन इज रेस्पायरेटरी सर्किट। द नॉन रेस्पायरेटरी सर्किट इन्वॉल्व दोज ब्लड वेसल्स विच आर सप्लाइंग द टिश्यूज ऑफ द रेस्पिरेटरी ट्री एंड लंग्स। Okay, the second system is the respiratory system or the pulmonary circuit across which the gas exchange occur. See here, first of all, we will discuss the non-respiratory circuit. Non-respiratory circuit means it is not involved in the gas exchange. There are some arteries which are supplying the bronchi, which are supplying the connective tissue of the lung and the visceral pleura. Similarly, every organ is supplied by some vessels. So, lung is also supplied by some vessel which is bronchial artery. So, bronchial arteries are the branches of descending thoracic aorta. This is descending thoracic aorta, and these are the bronchial arteries which are coming out from it. These bronchial arteries, they are supplying the bronchi, they will supply the connective tissue of the lung, and they will supply the visceral pleura. The bronchial veins, which are communicated with the pulmonary veins also, they drain into azygous vein and the hemiazygous vein. Azygous vein is present on the right side and hemiazygous vein will be present on the left side. So always remember that bronchial veins drain into the azygous and hemiazygous vein. This is non-respiratory circuit. That is, they are not involved with the gas exchange. They are only supplying the lungs, the visceral pleura and the bronchi. These are bronchial arteries, which are branches of descending thoracic aorta, and bronchial veins, which are communicated with the pulmonary veins, but they will drain in the azygous vein and hemiazygous vein. Now we will come towards respiratory or the pulmonary circuit. Respiratory or pulmonary circuit means those blood vessels which are involved with the gas exchange. These are the blood vessels which are carrying the deoxygenated blood to the alveoli for oxygenation. And then they are carrying the oxygenated blood from the alveoli towards the heart to be supplied to the body. So there are some arteries which are named as segmental arteries. These are branches of pulmonary artery. See here in this diagram, can you see this purple colored vessel? This is artery. Why this is in blue color or purple color? Because it is carrying deoxygenated blood. This deoxygenated blood is carried to the bronchopulmonary segments and alveoli, where the oxygenation will occur. Okay, oxygenation of blood will occur. Then what will happen? From the alveoli and the bronchopulmonary segments, the oxygenated blood is carried and it will go towards the heart through the pulmonary vein. So this is a circuit, which is a pulmonary circuit. How it starts? It starts from the pulmonary arteries. Pulmonary arteries will give many segmental arteries. These segmental arteries will carry the deoxygenated blood to the bronchopulmonary segments and to the alveoli. When the oxygenation is completed, then the intersegmental veins will carry that oxygenated blood from the alveolar capillaries and it will follow the connective tissue septa. I have told you before that the veins will not be present inside the bronchopulmonary segment, but the veins will be present in the connective tissue septa, which are bounding the bronchopulmonary segment. And these veins will carry the oxygenated blood to the pulmonary veins. Okay, and remember this thing, that the pulmonary veins are four in number, two on the right side and two on the left side, and they will come at the lung root. Then from the lung root, these pulmonary veins, they will empty into the left atrium of the heart. They will enter the left atrium of the heart and they will drain the oxygenated blood into the left atrium of the heart. And from the left atrium, the aorta will come out. See here, because what will happen? From left atrium, the blood will go into the left ventricle, and from left ventricle, the aorta will come out, which will supply the oxygenated blood to the all over the body. Again, I will repeat this whole system. See here, number one, these are pulmonary arteries. These pulmonary arteries is carrying the deoxygenated blood, and this deoxygenated blood is supplied or it is gone to the bronchopulmonary segments and alveoli through segmental arteries. In bronchopulmonary segments, the alveoli will do the oxygenation. Then what will happen? The oxygenated blood is carried through the intersegmental veins into the pulmonary veins. And the pulmonary veins will drain in the left atrium of the heart. From the left atrium, the oxygenated blood will go into the left ventricle. From the left ventricle, it is drained into the aorta. First the ascending aorta, then arch of aorta, and then descending thoracic aorta to be supplied all over the body. So the oxygenated blood is supplied to all over the body. Now, what is the lymphatic drainage of the lungs? The lymph vessels originate in two types of plexus. One is superficial plexus and one is deep plexus. They are not present in the alveolar wall. See here, this is superficial plexus. Here there will be superficial plexus and there will be deep plexus which will be present deeper in the lungs. So superficial plexus is also called as subpleural plexus because it is lying just beneath the pleura. Okay, it will lie just beneath the visceral pleura and it will drain over the surface of the lung toward the hilum. See the arrows, the direction of arrows. The subpleural plexus is draining the lung towards the hilum of the lung. Okay, where the lymph vessels enter the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. See here, this is bronchopulmonary lymph node. So subpleural plexus or the superficial plexus will drain in the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. Now we will talk about deep plexus. Deep plexus are present around the bronchi and the pulmonary vessels also. They will pass through the pulmonary nodes. First of all, they will pass through the pulmonary nodes which are located within the lung substance. Then the lymph enter the bronchopulmonary nodes in the hilum of the lung. Then the lymph will enter the tracheobronchial lymph nodes. See here, these are tracheobronchial lymph nodes. And from the tracheobronchial lymph nodes, the lymph will drain in the bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. This is bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. Again, I will repeat, there are two types of plexus. One is superficial plexus or subpleural plexus. See the cursor, subpleural plexus. It is present beneath the visceral pleura. This lymph will be drained into bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. These are bronchopulmonary lymph nodes, okay, which are present at the hilum of the lung. Number two, the deep plexus, they are present in the substance of the lung. Okay, they will pass the lymph or they will drain the lymph first to pulmonary nodes, number one, then to the bronchopulmonary nodes, okay, number two, then number three, that is the tracheobronchial lymph nodes, and number four is bronchomediastinal lymph nodes. So they will travel in this manner and ultimately the lymph is drained in the bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. Okay, bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. See here, I will show you with highlighter the deep plexus. See here, the deep plexus will drain first in the pulmonary nodes. These are pulmonary nodes. Then they will drain in the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. These are bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. Then they will go in the tracheobronchial lymph nodes. And then they will drain in the bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. This is bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. Okay. The nodes which are present around the trachea and bronchi will be named as tracheobronchial lymph nodes. The nodes which are present around the bronchi and the lung substance are called as bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. And the trunk which is present around the bronchi and in the mediastinum is called as bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. Okay, so this was the lymphatic drainage of the lungs. See here, now we will come towards the nerve supply of the lung. Okay, there is the sympathetic nerve fiber and the parasympathetic nerve fibers. Remember, always in all organs, the parasympathetic nerve fibers are derived from the vagus nerve. Vagus nerve is the 10th cranial nerve. It is the longest cranial nerve which is present in our body, and it is supplying the parasympathetic nerve fibers to many organs. Okay, so there are two types of nerve supply: sympathetic nerve fibers, which are derived from the sympathetic chain. See here the sympathetic chain. This is sympathetic chain, okay? This is sympathetic chain on the right side, and this is the sympathetic chain on the, or sympathetic trunk on the left side. Then there are parasympathetic nerve fibers, which are derived from the vagus nerve. See here, this is vagus nerve, okay? So this vagus nerve will give many parasympathetic nerve fibers. And there are many visceral efferent fibers which will intermingle at the root of each lung and form the pulmonary plexus. See here, this is pulmonary plexus. This pulmonary plexus is formed by the combination of sympathetic fibers, parasympathetic fibers, and some of the visceral efferent fibers. They all will intermingle and they will form the pulmonary plexus at the hilum of the lung. Branches from the pulmonary plexus mainly follow the bronchi into and within the lungs. So they will enter the lungs and they will supply the lung. So remember 3 points here. Number 1 point, sympathetic nerve fibers from the sympathetic chain. Number 2, parasympathetic nerve fibers from the vagus nerve. Number 3, visceral efferent fibers. These three types of fibers, they will form the pulmonary plexus. This pulmonary plexus is present at the root of each lung. Branches from the pulmonary plexus will follow the bronchi and they will enter the lungs. Now, this is a chart in which they have shown the sympathetic nerve fibers function and parasympathetic nerve fibers function in the lungs. So, in the sympathetic supply, the bronchodilation will be there, okay, which is inhibitory to the bronchial smooth muscle. There is vasoconstriction and there are inhibitory signals to the alveolar glands of the bronchial tree. But in the parasympathetic, it will be opposite: the bronchoconstriction, vasodilatation, and it is secretomotor to the glands of the bronchial tree. This you will learn in physiology in detail. Now, the most important thing which we have to discuss today is lung root. Okay, lung root. More specifically, the lung root has many structures which are present in it. This is lung root. See here the cursor. This is lung root. This is the mediastinal surface or the medial surface of the lungs. Can you see the mediastinal surface of the lung? Okay, this is mediastinal surface of the lung. Okay, so here they have shown the root of the lung. The root of the lung will have a principal bronchus. See here, this is principal bronchus. Principal bronchus. Okay, then there will be pulmonary artery. See here, a pulmonary artery. Then there are pulmonary veins. I have told you, two pulmonary veins on the right side and two pulmonary veins on the left side. See here, this is left lung. How we have recognized that this is left lung? Because there is cardiac notch or cardiac impression. Because heart is present on the left side, so the left lung has a cardiac impression. So this is left lung. See here, there is a mild difference in between the root of the right lung and the left lung. In the left lung, there is only one bronchus. There is only one bronchus which is below the pulmonary artery. Pulmonary artery will be above. Then below it, there will be bronchus. And anterior to it and below it, there are two pulmonary veins. Two pulmonary veins, which are called as superior pulmonary vein and inferior pulmonary vein. Along with the superior and inferior pulmonary veins, there are small bronchial veins are also present. Some of the lymphatics, bronchopulmonary lymph nodes, areolar tissue, and pulmonary nerve plexus is also present in the root of the lung. Again, the most important point of the lung root, that there are three main components. What are they? Number one, pulmonary artery. Number two, bronchus. Number three, pulmonary veins. Again, I will repeat. Number one, pulmonary artery. See the cursor. This is carrying the deoxygenated blood. That's why it is purple or blue in color. This is pulmonary artery. then bronchus. On the left side, there is only one bronchus which is shown here. Then two pulmonary veins, one is superior pulmonary vein and one is inferior pulmonary vein. They are red in color because they are carrying the oxygenated blood. Along with these three structures, there are some other structures also. What are they? Number one, bronchial arteries, which are one on one side and two on the other side. Bronchial veins, anterior and posterior pulmonary nerve plexus, lymphatics, bronchopulmonary lymph nodes and areolar tissue. Now we will see the lung root of the right side. See here, the bronchus is divided into two parts. One is called as epiarterial bronchus, and the below one is called as hyperarterial bronchus. Why they are called as epiarterial and hyperarterial bronchus? Ep means above, that is, it is above the pulmonary artery, so it is called as epiarterial bronchus, and one bronchus will be below the pulmonary artery, so it is called as hyperarterial bronchus. They are present on the right side, and then there will be two pulmonary veins, superior pulmonary and inferior pulmonary vein, and one pulmonary artery. See here, one pulmonary artery, two pulmonary veins, and then there will be two bronchial arteries on this side, bronchial veins, anterior and posterior pulmonary nerve plexus, lymphatics, bronchopulmonary lymph nodes and areolar tissue. These are the components of the lung root. For revision, I will repeat again. See here, on the right side in this slide, this is right lung. How we have recognized that this is right lung? Now, because there is no cardiac impression here and there are two bronchi here. One bronchus is called as epiarterial bronchus and the below bronchus is called as hyperarterial bronchus. They have shown the two pulmonary artery here because they have taken it in section. So here they have shown the two pulmonary arteries, but almost there is only one pulmonary artery which is present, and the bronchus which will be above that pulmonary artery will be called as epiarterial, and the bronchus which is below the pulmonary artery will be hyperarterial bronchus. Then there are two pulmonary veins, superior and inferior. Then there are many other structures also which I have told you. But on the left side, we can see a large pulmonary artery, a single bronchus and two pulmonary veins. See here, two pulmonary veins. You can see here the pulmonary ligament. Can you see the pulmonary ligament here? This is also a recess or an empty space which will provide the structures or the great vessels to dilate during respiration. So it is providing a space for the vessels to relax and contract. See here, again I have pasted here the diagram of the root of the lung. See here, this is pulmonary artery which is shown in blue color because it is carrying the deoxygenated blood. There are two bronchi, one is above, so it is called as epiarterial, and one is below, which is called as hyperarterial bronchus. Then there are two pulmonary veins. This is bronchial artery and there are bronchial lymph nodes. But on the left side, there is one main bronchus. This bronchus will not be present, which is above the pulmonary artery. Only there will be one bronchus here, one pulmonary artery and two pulmonary veins. One is superior, one is inferior. Bronchial arteries will be there and bronchial lymph nodes will be there. And this is pulmonary ligament. In exam, they can ask you to draw this diagram. They will ask you that draw the diagram of the root of the right lung and the left lung, and what is the difference between the components of the roots of right lung and left lung. See here again, this bronchus which is drawn here will not be present, will not be present. Okay, see here, this bronchus will not be present. This bronchus, I am cutting it. This bronchus will not be present on the left side because there is only one bronchus which is present, okay, which is below the pulmonary artery. Now, Again, I have pasted here all diagram. This is for the right side. See here, these are two pulmonary arteries. Okay, they have shown, and this is the bronchi. One is superior. This is also called as epiarterial or superior lobar bronchus, and there is inferior lobar bronchus. And these are the pulmonary arteries. Okay, and there will be pulmonary veins. This is pulmonary veins. Then there are many bronchial veins will be there, and many other structures will be there. Okay, so you can see here. Here they have shown the impressions also. In practical, they can ask you these impressions. See here on the right side, we have esophageal area below the apex. This is apex, okay? This is mediastinal surface of the right lung, okay? Mediastinal surface of the right lung. This is apex. This is esophagus impression or esophageal area. Then anterior to it, there will be tracheal area, because you know this thing that trachea is anterior to the esophagus. Then this is the groove for the brachiocephalic vein. This is the groove for the first rib. This is anterior border. Okay. Then there will be groove for the superior vena cava, because superior vena cava is also present on the right side. This is a small cardiac impression. Okay. Small cardiac impression will be there, which is for right auricle and right atrium. Then here they have shown the horizontal fissure, and this is oblique fissure. You remember that there are two fissures in the right lung. This is the groove for the inferior vena cava. There was groove for the superior vena cava. This was superior vena cava groove, and there is groove for the inferior vena cava. This is pulmonary ligament. This is inferior border. Inferior border is bounding the base or the diaphragmatic surface. This is posterior border of the lung. Posterior border of the lung. This is the groove for the azygous vein, which will drain in the superior vena cava. So these are the impressions which are present in the mediastinal surface of the right lung. Now we will see the mediastinal surface of the left lung. See here, this is apex. Okay, again there will be tracheal and esophageal impressions, because trachea and esophagus, they are present in the middle. Then there is a groove for the arch of aorta. Remember this thing. From this groove of the arch of aorta, you can recognize that this is left lung. And with this cardiac notch, a big cardiac impression will be present here. An arch of aorta, because arch of aorta is present on the left side only. Just like superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, which were present on the right side, here there will be arch of aorta. So there is a big impression for the arch of aorta. Okay, this is arch of aorta, then this is descending thoracic aorta. Then there is area for esophagus also. This is inferior border. There is diaphragmatic surface, which is also called as the base. This is lingula. Do you remember lingula? Lingula is the lower part of the anterior border, which is below the cardiac impression. It is a tongue-like projection, so it is called as lingula. This is cardiac impression. This is root of the lung. Root of lung, on left side, there will be one pulmonary artery, one bronchus, and two pulmonary veins. On the right side, we had two pulmonary arteries, two bronchi, and two pulmonary veins. Okay, here then there will be groove for the subclavian artery. Groove for the subclavian artery, groove for first rib. This is anterior border. So these were the structures having impressions on the mediastinal surface of the right lung and the left lung. So remember these structures also. See here, this is trachea. The trachea is divided into three lobar or principal, three principal bronchi. See here, two principal bronchi, one for the right lung and one for the left lung. These principal bronchus, they are called as main bronchus. Then the main primary or principal bronchi, they will divide into secondary or lobar bronchus. Those will be three. Two are principal because there are two lungs. Okay, so they are called as principal or main or primary because there are two lungs. So two principal bronchus. Then each principal bronchus will divide into secondary or lobar bronchi. Because there are three lobes on the right side, so there will be three secondary or lobar bronchi on the right side and two secondary or lobar bronchi on the left side. Count here, this is one, which is called as right superior lobar bronchus, then right middle lobar bronchus and right inferior lobar bronchus. Three, because there are three lobes on the right side. Lobar or secondary are same. Then on the left side, there are two, because there are two lobes. One is superior and one is inferior. So you have to remember this with heart. Now, there is one procedure which is called as thoracocentesis. Thoracocentesis, it comes from a Greek word thorax and centesis. Thora means thorax or chest, and centesis means puncture. This is an invasive procedure associated with the removal of the fluid or air from the pleural space for diagnostic or therapeutic purposes. The thoracocentesis site should be in the mid-scapular. See here, it will be in the mid-scapular or posterior axillary line. It will be 6 to 10 centimeters lateral to the spine, okay? Spine of the vertebra. It will be 6 to 10 centimeters lateral to the spine and 1 to 2 intercostal spaces below the highest level of effusion. 1 to 2 intercostal spaces below the highest level of effusion. For example, if there is effusion up till 4th rib, okay, 4th rib. So we will pass the needle in 6th rib, because 6th will be 2 intercostal spaces below the highest level of effusion, which was at the level of 4th rib or 4th costal cartilage, so that the needle will be passed or will be present in the fluid and the bag will be attached to the needle, and then the fluid will come in that bag or it will drain in that bag. Okay, this is called as thoracocentesis. Now, this is another procedure which is called as thoracoscopy. Thoracoscopy means to see inside the thorax. We can see inside the thorax by an instrument which is called as thoracoscope. This is thoracoscope which they have entered, okay, while the patient is in this position, left lateral position, and the thoracoscope is entered to see the internal structure or internal things which are present here in the thorax. Is there any inflammation or pus or any tumor or anything which is present in the thorax? The instrument is called as thoracoscope and the procedure is called as thoracoscopy. Okay, thoracoscopy. Now, there can be bronchoscopy also. The bronchoscope can be passed through the bronchi to see the bronchus. See here on the right side, there will be three segmental bronchi, and on the left side, there will be two segmental bronchi. There will be two segmental bronchi. But the main point at which the one trachea will be divided into two principal bronchi, that point is called as carina. Remember this thing, carina means the point at which the trachea divide into two principal bronchi. So that is called as carina. Okay, in case of foreign body, because the foreign bodies are usually impacted on the right side of the bronchus, because the right bronchus is more vertical, it is smaller and more in diameter. Okay, and more vertical or in more line with the trachea. So the foreign body can be inhaled inside the right side of the bronchus, not on the left side. So to see that foreign body or to examine the bronchi, we can pass a bronchoscope through the trachea. This is called as bronchoscopy. Now, this is a diagram in which they have shown a tumor. See here, this is a mass which they have shown. Okay, mass in the anterior segment of the right upper lobe. This is in the bronchogenic carcinoma. Read the bronchogenic carcinoma from KLM. Okay, it can be small size, small cell carcinoma, or many other types of carcinomas can be there. The main cause is cigarette smoking. The main cause is cigarette smoking. If a tumor is limited to one bronchopulmonary segment, then only one segment is removed, or it can be excised very carefully and it can be removed very easily. This is called a segmentectomy. Okay, if whole of the lung is removed, this is called as pleurectomy. If one lobe is removed, it is called as lobectomy. So all these names are written in KNM, so please read all those names. Okay, now we can examine the lungs. There can be physical examination of lungs. For the physical examination of a patient, remember that upper lobes of the lungs are most easily examined from the front of the chest, and the lower lobes from the back. This is very, very important. Areas of all lobes can be examined in the axilla. Now, there can be lung trauma. A splinter from a fractured rib